Step 11, I find inherent connections. And step 11 is the hard one. So I'm going to say that A is B and A is C. There are two is's in this stuff. And the first one is the big is, IS, or equals sign. A equals B and A equals C. And at this point, I don't know what I am saying. I don't know what I am talking about. I will see. So I'm saying A, something that isn't here but insists, is an ordinary space arrangement. And also something that isn't here but insists is anyhow connecting. So when I said A is C, something that isn't here but insists is anyhow connect, then I wanted to say ing.
Connecting.
Now it's connecting, yes.
Connecting.
The first important thing about this equating, this is that you break, you get rid of, you avoid, you walk around all the usual old logic that we have all learned. So to communicate that quickly, people are doing a Spanish translation of the process model. So one of the proposals that came back in Spanish was a model of process. And I went wild. I said, no, we can't have that. That destroys everything. Why? Because a model of process has already split between the concepts and the thing that it's about, you see? It has already made the model into an old dead model that I don't want by using the word model in the way that it's here, and it's about something that's over there. And all the poor people did is they translated a process model, you know? Do you see what I mean? Well, that's what we avoid when we put is in between A and B and A and C. And of course it doesn't work right away, because something that isn't here but insists is not really, that's not true what we have here. It's not really an ordinary spatial arrangement. I'm stuck. I don't want to say it in the old terms. It produces, it makes, it creates. So you always have one thing here and one thing there, and then you have a rubber band that's called a relationship. That's no good. When you stick is in between A and B, or the equal sign between A and B, you are breaking that whole old story. And you're saying something wild and completely wrong for the moment. And then I'm going to fix it. But I'm going to fix it from inside it, not from the usual grammar. And if you do this and you write like this, you will find that the whole world wants to put you back into the old grammar. Every editor is telling me that I can't say the body is interaction. No, I'm saying no, the body is interaction. And only that is any good. Something that isn't here but insists is an ordinary space arrangement, then I want to fix that sentence until it's not false. Is implicitly a space arrangement? Still not right, but better. Something that isn't here but insists, comma, can insist on an ordinary space arrangement. Could I say that? Now look what's happening. Whatever I'm going to put in here, it's going to make new, fresh structure. It's my living in the facet. So if you say, now define what you mean by insists, I can't do that yet. That's step 12. I'll get there. But what do I now mean by insists? Whatever happened to me when I was standing at the computer and the goddamn thing wouldn't let me fix the first page? That's what I mean. That's what I mean. And that's what I'm inviting you to do, please. To actually hang on to the living experience of it. Then all the different things you say, you're free. You can call it God, you can call it the devil, you can call it bullshit, you can call it anything you want. As long as you're hanging on to the living thing, you're okay. Do you see what I mean? A is B, I'm writing. because I can look over here and fill it in. A is something that isn't here yet but insists. I need something shorter. I don't want to have to say that whole long thing every time. NHI. So it doesn't always insist. Or sometimes I may have to ask it to please come and... So I'm going to write can insist. So notice, I'm changing something. It's mine. I can change it anytime I want to. Something that isn't here but can insist. I'm calling that NHI. Can insist on ordinary space arrangements. Now, what do I do now? I want to use that word twice, but that I could do that for the moment, but okay, so I'm doing something interesting again. I'm saying, what's the relation? Then I remember, well, don't invent the damn relation. Go in there and see what is the relation. Oh, of course, the relation is the very same insist that I already have in A. So naturally, that's right. So something that isn't here but can insist on ordinary space arrangements. Now I accept the clumsiness of it because I understand it. I can either take the is away because now the is no longer needed because I put something new in there, or you can always turn the is into is something which. And for the purpose of logic, which comes in step 12, that's important to know. So I could say something that isn't here but can insist is something which. I have to show you quick. In step 11, I say to myself, what is the inherent relation between these two terms, A and B, and then A and C? But what is an inherent relation? An inherent relation means that what is an NHI anyway, such that it is already an implicit or a spatial arrangement. I am insisting that whatever A is, it's already B. And so that must mean that whatever B is already A. In some way. I want to communicate this inherent A is already B, B is already A. But I need you to see what happens there to me, and I'm glad I'm modeling it because I can go in there. So when I say something that isn't here but can insist, in some way is already creative of space arrangements, is already the source of space arrangements, is already the of space arrangements. I suddenly have a respect for ordinary space arrangements, which I always wanted to have and I never could get it quite. But as soon as I do it the other way, which should be the same thing, and I say, space arrangements are inherently, from the start, always, already, in themselves, something that was insisted or could be insisted by something that isn't here yet, I get the shivers. I get the feeling that, oh, the whole world